I'll call the April 19th, 2021 council meeting to order. At this time, the Honorable Tom Audette will lead us in invocation and pledge of allegiance.
Lord, thank you for this time, for us, for your guidance to lead, to help lead, and to look to support this county. Lord, we thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, if the following individuals would come forward to be sworn into oath of office, if you'll come forward, Nicole Druckmiller and Creighton Hayes for York County Forever, Stephen Ballinger, Ashley Platts, Marie McFadden, Elizabeth Buke, Marion Ray, and Marilyn Hakem for Keep York County Beautiful, Billy Dunlap, Old English District, Barbara Candler, Tony Smith, and Derek Williams for Zoning Board of Appeals, Ron Domerat for Lake Wylie Parks and Recreation District, Lisa Arrowwood, Benjamin Bolding for Catawba Regional Workforce Investment Board, and Joe Costello for the Bethel Fire Tax District Board. Wow, we have a big crowd. Well, on behalf of the council, we typically don't engage at this meeting, but we do want to say thank you so much for what you do. As a council, we can't get everything possibly done, and it's incumbent upon the folks that serve voluntarily on these boards to make sure that the county operates well, and we do appreciate all of the work that you're doing to help us, and we look forward to your serving on these boards. This time, if Wanda Hemphill will come forward, she's going to provide us some, Wanda is the Executive Director of Voter Registration. She's going to provide us some information and update.
Thank you. Again, I'm Wanda Hemphill, the Director of the Board of Voter Registration Elections, York County. I appreciate you having me here this evening. We're going to talk about some municipal county election procedures. We've been having a lot of questions regarding that topic, but before I begin, I would like to thank County Council for their continued support and funding. And as you all know, 2020 presidential was a very large event, big election, and it required a lot of resources. And one of those things is certainly funding. And I just wanted to give you a few statistics on some of the great things that we were able to do with that funding that you provided to us. In York County, we had a 73.32% turnout. That was higher than the statewide average of 72%. We cast or voted out just slightly less than 145,000 people for that election. So that, by volume, that was the largest number of folks that we've ever voted out. Part of that, I think contributing factor to that was the fact that we had two satellite voting in-person absentee sites as well as the main site. And we voted out a total absentee of about 70,000 with about 47,000 being in person. York, we voted out about 18,000. Fort Mill was around 15, and Rock Hill was around 14. So had we not been able to do that, we would have had tremendously long lines at the polls on election day. So we were able to avoid some of that congestion, and I just want to thank you again, you know, for your continued support and funding. Moving on to municipal elections, kind of give you a little back history on that, how we became involved in that. A lot of municipalities across South Carolina still conduct their own elections. We transferred elections from municipalities over to the county quite a few years ago. Rock Hill came about in 1995. The last municipality we transferred was the City of York, but when I became director in 2003, that was one of my goals, was to try to get all of the municipalities on the same election cycle, because they were all over the calendar. Some were November of even years, some odd years, some in June, some in April, so they were scattered around the calendar. So when we reached out to the municipalities, it was right after we had gone to the statewide uniform voting system. And so one of the requirements was that all counties and municipalities had to use that system. So at that time, we worked collectively with the municipalities, but part of the agreement was we will take over and we will allow for the transfer of powers over to the county board if you get on the November of odd year cycles. So we have eight of the nine municipalities on that cycle, and reciprocating ordinances were passed for that transfer of powers, and the last being the City of York. We have municipal elections that are going to be held this fall, and we have redistricting that's going to be taking place also somewhere in that timeline, and maybe later. As you may have all heard, the census data has been delayed and going to be delayed. It probably will not arrive, they're estimating, until late September. So that is creating a lot of challenges for everyone, not just municipalities, but also you will have to deal with that as a county council, state house, state senate, and other political bodies such as school boards. So that is going to delay that timeline for you know, a lot of political subdivisions. So I just wanted to kind of give you a little background on the history of how we became involved in elections, what our role is, and the history of that, and let you know as far as going into the fall elections, what we have on the calendar. We do have Rock Hill in October, and then the other municipalities is always the first Monday following the first Tuesday in November. So I just wanted to apprise you of that and bring you up to speed.
Thank you, Wanda. Obviously, it's critical to our democracy that we have a fair process for how this works, and we appreciate all that you and your staff do to make sure that happens. I don't think I was aware of the fact that there were actually an ordinance that the county was involved in with the municipalities when it comes to doing the elections. And as I understand it, all of the cities within our county are following the November process, but except for the City of Rock Hill, is that?
That's correct.
Okay. Are there any questions of that you have of Wanda? Mr. Roddy?
Yeah. So out of nine municipalities in York County, we only have one who is still operating outside of the November election date.
Correct. And when I became director, that process had already taken place. They were already set for October. But I was able to get the other municipalities on the November of odd years.
What's the cost implication of running an election outside of the normal November cycle when everybody else is in the pool of elections as far as cost sharing, running a separate election? What kind of costs are we looking at for a municipality?
There would be some cost sharing if Rock Hill were on the same cycle. Maybe not as much as what you would think, because cost is driven a lot by how many precincts do we open and how many workers do we deploy. And of course, each municipality is going to have their own separate set of precincts. But there would be opportunity to do some cost sharing. But probably along with that, I would say that the greatest concern and the challenges that we have is one, the logistics of running multiple elections, particularly if Rock Hill has a runoff. And then we may have a special election coupled with that. In 2017, we just had a series of elections going on. That can create some voter fatigue. It can also, which will affect, you know, potential turnout. It also creates some confusion with voters, because every 2 years that we run the Rock Hill City election, we always have the question, why are they in October and everybody else is in November? And then we will receive calls in November wanting to know where to go vote. We said, well, they just voted 3 weeks ago. So it does create some confusion with the public. And if we were able to get them on the same cycle, it would be beneficial from a logistics standpoint, some cost sharing, but then also to be able to better utilize the media and make it like a municipal general election day. And that is one of the goals of the State Election Commission, is to try to encourage municipalities to all get on the November odd year date so we can have a statewide municipal election day.
Like a big Super Tuesday. How many municipalities throughout the state of South Carolina do you know of off the top of your head who are still kind of operating outside of the November? I know the Municipal Association has been trying to push these types of behaviors across the state with municipalities to get on this November election cycle.
Yes, they have been encouraging municipalities to get on to the November cycle. And I actually have a good statistic here. In 2015, there were 123 municipalities who ran on the November odd date. In 2021 current day, 162. So it went from 45% to 60%. So we're seeing a progression. And municipalities moving in that direction to get on that November date. So we are seeing movement with that.
Now, you may not have this statistic. Out of those who were doing it outside of the November election, were these county-run elections, or were some municipalities still doing, obviously, their own thing and running the elections?
It's a combination of both. Some counties chose to accept the transfer of powers without asking the municipalities to change the date.
All right, and my final question, any logical reason to have elections outside of November? A general election?
Back when we had asked certain municipalities to change their dates, I think sometimes it's just it feels like, well, that's what we've always done kind of mentality and somewhat of tradition. And I think that some of this goes back, my understanding with the City of Rock Hill, back when they ran partisan elections, their primary was in October, and then they would run their general election in January. So I think that's what that stems from. But other than just it being just something of a traditional value or something like that, I don't know what the benefit, you know, would be to the city.
Is it still your goal to get everybody in York County on a November cycle?
We would love to be able to do that. Again, for a lot of the reasons that I mentioned previously. I have not formally asked the City of Rock Hill. I don't think that I would need to. This comes up every 2 years. And when they come into file, you know, I'll have that conversation with the incumbents, the sitting members, and even new candidates. And they all say, yeah, I know, we really need to take a look at that. But then nothing ever really, it never seems to get legs and go anywhere. That's something that we would continue to encourage, and even the media has picked up on it. And I've done several interviews, you know, over the years, and they always question, why does Rock Hill have theirs in October? So, but if you really want to know, then that would be a question for the city of Rock Hill.
So Wanda, what can the county do to help you accomplish that mission?
Well, I think just having that discussion tonight is helpful. You know, the onus is on the city to make that change. It is their responsibility to do that. I've kind of hoped over the years that eventually they would see the wisdom and go ahead and make that change. You know, but in all fairness, I'm not sure what it is, their reservations, what it is that they haven't moved forward with that.
I had not heard the term voter fatigue, but people are only going to show up for so many, and I think
that's
that,
right.
You know, the people that are running, as all of, you know, all of us people who have had campaigns, and we all know how important it is for people to show up when it's time to vote, and the easier we make that for them to do, and the more people they can vote for at one time, it just seems like that's so much more effective and efficient, and the goal is to have as many people vote in every election, and so I just feel like if we could simplify that, maybe we can get Rock Hill on board and make that a countywide goal.
Yes, and I think all the points that you mentioned are very valid, and I agree with that 100%.
I wouldn't want to be the one out there, you know, at some odd time, you know, some odd date trying to...
It does generate a lot of conversation, you know, every 2 years when we run their separate from the others.
So we fund you as a county, and I don't know the answers to these questions, so excuse me for asking maybe too many questions, but so the county funds, but do the municipalities also help fund the elections?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
Basically, what we do is we invoice them out for the cost of that election minus their filing fees, and that's what they reimburse us for.
So if there is a municipality that's running at a different time, is their cost higher, or is it, I mean, I just wonder what the financial incentive might be, if there is one.
It would be, some aspects of it would be higher because they're not able to share some of the cost with the other municipalities. And like for instance, in I think the last Pennies program, I'll defer to Michael, I can't remember when that was, but I was thinking it was in November of an odd year, and so we were able to cost share between, you know, the county was between that Pennies program referendum and the other municipality. So it was really a win-win for everyone. So it would be nice and a good goal for everyone to kind of move and be on that same election cycle for cost saving as well as to prevent voter fatigue and any confusion.
Thank you.
Wanda, on the census numbers, whenever we're waiting on them with them being delayed, does that affect this year's election? So if they're coming out in late September and then people are voting in November, and lines may be redrawn, does it come in play immediately, or is that delayed a year?
That's a great question. And I think that's the million-dollar question right now with some municipalities. And I think one of those being the city of Rock Hill, that is going to impact the timeline, but there's options available, and each municipality is going to have to weigh the possibility of any legal challenges to what's best for their citizens. With it coming in September, municipalities, could either go ahead and run on the old lines, or they could delay or postpone the election and in the interim redistrict. There could be potential legal challenges to either method, but it would be up to each municipality to kind of determine the risk level and what they think is best for municipalities. I did find out today in talking with my counterpart in Greenville County, they mirror their filing. Of course, they run partisan in Greenville, but they mirror their process just like a regular general election process, and they just ended filing. So they're going to go ahead and move forward with having an election on the old, on the current lines. I won't say old lines, but on the current lines. And so, you know, each municipality will have to make that decision and weigh that.
Yeah, I could see that. I could see that one being a big issue. Finding out what your district is in late September and having an election in November would be extremely tough, or October.
Yes, and if you're looking at and a lot of people not realizing what's involved in the redistricting process, when they're going to have to get the data in, which is going to come in late September, they'll have to use that data to draft a plan, open it up for public comment and hearings, and then once they decide on that plan, it would have to be approved and go through the readings of the city council, and then as an office, our office would then have to be able to take that data and figure out where we need to move those voters and redistrict them. So it is quite a process, you know, that, that takes a while. So decisions are going to have to be made soon.
Thank you.
So, quick question here. Well, first of all, thank you for all your hard work and your team's hard work. Great job. One thing, secure elections is critical. And from a county standpoint, from a state legislative standpoint, what more could we do from a council to help secure our elections? And then is there, you know, from a state legislative perspective, what would you say would be something they could do to help secure elections?
Actually, I think South Carolina does a great job comparatively to other states. Mm-hmm. From a cybersecurity standpoint, I think that we are very well postured. We're ahead of a lot of other states. York County has always been very supportive of our department, you know, in that area. I think the IT division does a fantastic job. We take a lot of internal steps and implement measures to make sure that the vote is protected. Mm-hmm. So I think we do a lot in York County and South Carolina already, you know, as far as securing the vote.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
I have just one quick question. You mentioned the process of the getting the new census numbers and then redoing the lines, and then it comes to you. Does it have to go back to Columbia for anything, if that, for an approval down there when they've redone their lines, or is that just left up to the courts to, if somebody decides that they gerrymandered too much or something? So,
well, it can always be challenged, but that's why it would be open for public comment. And so you would, you know, different groups and advocacy groups would have that opportunity to participate in that process, you know, as that political subdivision is drawing it, just much like what you will have to do as a county council. A lot of times what local bodies will do is if they will actually get the RFA, it used to be Research and Statistics, it's Revenue and Fiscal Affairs now, will actually need to get on a list to have them draw the lines for the smaller towns and cities that maybe don't have the IT personnel and the software applications and things to be able to do that. Some larger municipalities may have the ability to do a lot of that work themselves, but then consult with Columbia and have them review the plan, you know, before it would be enacted. One of the differences now too is that we're not required to gain preclearance on those redistricting plans as it once was. So that will help eliminate and shave off some of the time also.
Thank you.
I got one more.
Mr. Ryder.
I have one more question for you. Which way you think would pose the biggest legal challenge, running on the old lines or delaying elections, waiting on the new lines to be drawn? Which one do you see being the biggest pathway to a legal challenge down the road?
That's a tough question because I'm not privy to what the data looks like. support the city of Rock Hill. I think it may depend on if they are significantly malapportioned, if their districts are, and they don't redistrict, they could run a risk, you know, because of the 14th Amendment, one man, one vote, equal protection. So, and I haven't seen that data, and they may have some idea by using some other types of data that they could maybe ballpark and see where all that growth is and see perhaps how malapportioned they are. But until we get the census data, we don't know. So they would run the risk of a legal challenge if they are significantly malapportioned. You know, likewise, if they decide to run on the current lines, they could face a legal challenge that way too. And that's, you know, the tough decisions that the city is going to have to look at and hopefully carefully weigh, you know, all of the legal advice that they receive, as well as, you know, weighing that against the interest of the voters and the citizens of Rock Hill. I know that's not a direct answer, but that's about the best I can give without knowing all of the particulars.
Any other questions? I completely understand your point about bringing us all along on the same schedule, and your point is well taken. The only other question I have is if there is a need to move elections to a different time frame because of the census data being unavailable, is that something that you have a recommendation on how it should be conducted? Should they all be done at a later date, at the same date, or should they be?
As far as the nine municipalities, the only ones that would be affected by that would be City of Rock Hill, City of York. Fort Mill operates a little bit differently. York and Rock Hill have true single member district seats. They have like 5-2 plant. No, they don't. Fort Mill has 5-2. But they have single member districts. Fort Mill, what they have are geographic filing areas. And so there may not be as great a sense of urgency, you know, for them to redistrict because everybody votes at large. They file by district, but everyone votes at large. So I'm sure that they will be looking at that too. The rest of the municipalities all vote at large, so they're not going to be affected by this redistricting process. So the two most possible candidates, or as far as municipalities to possibly move, would be Rock Hill and York. And so I'm not sure the position that either of those cities are going to take at this time.
Okay.
Did that answer?
Mr. Winkler?
Would your recommendation, I've heard talk in some of those two municipalities about moving one ward or postponing one ward or one district or something. Would your recommendation be to do that or to move the entire election wholesale if it came to that? I would think, my thinking, and I'll put words in your mouth, but mm-hmm. moving one would cause more problems, I would think, as far as lawsuits and stuff, because when you redo the lines, there's going to be people that voted in the others that weren't eligible under the new lines or vice versa. So.
That's right. And I've heard, you know, a couple of different versions of what you're talking about. I've heard, you know, a version of running one ward separate from the other wards or mayor's race. Would not recommend that. No, I don't, I wouldn't understand the logic behind that, separating one individual ward out from the others, because they're all going to be affected, you know, by that process. I've also heard about the potential of a mayor's race being separated from, you know, the three ward races that may be up. Although I understand from a legal standpoint kind of why they would maybe be looking at that as an option, I don't know that just because you can that you should. I think that separating elections like that, again, would create more voter confusion than anything, and potential lawsuits. So
I think that would suppress turnout.
No, I don't.
Time,
so. it, any version of that, I think is going to be problematic.
Thank you.
One more real quick, sorry. Would it not make sense to just, if the redistricting was done after the November election, would that not solve most of the problems?
That would be the easiest option, I will say that. You know, but again, that goes back to these municipalities weighing the potential of legal challenges, and which is going to be the lesser, okay, of that. And that's information and insights that I'm not privy to as far as what type of legal advice they've sought out and received, in this. And ultimately, this may end up involving the courts. That's not uncommon in a redistricting process. So it could be that the courts will just simply decide.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate your help.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
At this time, we'll move to the public forum session. There's only one individual that signed up, Dr. Norma Gray, if you'll make your way up front. If you'll just make sure to say, state your name and your address. And there's 2 minutes that everyone, I hate calling time on folks, so you'll see on the thing when it starts blinking.
Absolutely.
If you can
hear me through my mask.
You can take it, it's up to you.
I've been fully vaccinated, so thank you. So Dr. Norma Gray, 407 Marshall Street in Rock Hill, South Carolina. And I came to speak exactly on the issue that Wanda Hemphill spoke with Wanda probably about maybe a week or so ago. I got a call from a new resident to Rock Hill asking the question, and she got something in the mail that she was confused about. Why was the Rock Hill election being held in October? She was very confused about it, and I couldn't give her an answer. I was born in Rock Hill, as I've let this council know before, and moved back 28 years ago, and never really gave much thought to the fact that our election was held in October. As she said, it's just something we've done ever since I was of voting age, but didn't realize that it's only been done for 26 years. Being a parent of a 30-year-old and a 28-year-old, 26 years is not a long time. So thinking about that, I had no answer for the person that asked me that question, why aren't our election in Rock Hill held in October? So I began to do some digging, and found out that we were the only lone star out there in all of York County holding our elections in October. Had the conversation with Wanda, and it's of great concern to me as we have so many new residents that have moved into Rock Hill. I think it's gonna be greatly confusing with the redistricting. Should we have a general election in October, do the redistricting, and then hold other elections at some other time? With the political climate the way it is, with a lot of people thinking about voter suppression, I am one for one person, one vote. I do think that it would behoove the counties to get the numbers right, and I think it would only best serve us if all of your county is synchronized. I think it sends a great message of unity. I think it would bring clarity to all of the residents that this is when elections are held, not only for now, but for future generations. This is a very different Rock Hill from 1995, and we're looking to the future. And as people move into Rock Hill, in Rock Hill, we say this is one Rock Hill, and we want to say this is one York County. So I would encourage this council to really take a look at that. And what Wanda has said tonight, I think she makes a very valid point that municipalities are all moving in that direction. And so I would encourage you all, as much as is possible, that lies in your power to do so, to encourage us that let's just move in that direction. This redistricting is going to be big and major.
Thank you, Dr. Gray.
For everyone, considering the fact that the census data is late, people are going to be scrambling, but we do want to get it right.
Thank you, Dr.
Gray. Once we get it right, we want everybody to be able to vote with the right power in the right district. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Do we have a motion on consent agenda?
Move to approve consent.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, motion passes. We're moving straight to committee and other reports. Planning and Economic Development Committee meeting, the Honorable Chairman Joel Hamilton.
Planning and operating, or sorry, Planning and Economic Development Committee meeting occurred on March 31st. Present were other committee members, Councilwoman Love, as well as Councilman Tom Audette. The committee received a presentation from David Swenson, our director who's present, regarding business development, retention, marketing, as well as an update on product development, including the Allison Creek Business Park, as well as the East York Industrial Park spec building.
Thank you, Mr. Hamilton. Finance and Operations Committee, Chairman Robert Winkler.
Thank you. Finance and Operations met today at 5:30, and we considered the following applications for service. We made the motion for the appointment of Joel Wood to fill an unexpired term on the York County Natural Gas Board, for Robin Peterson to fill an unexpired term on Keep York County Beautiful for District 1, for Lisa Mosley for an at-large seat on the York County Convention Visitors Bureau, for Sandra Calhoun for a first term and Victoria Nolf for a first term for two vacant positions on Catawba Mental Health Board, for James Spratt for a first term on a vacant seat for Riverview Fire Tax District, for Don Clark for a vacant seat on the Rock Hill York County Airport Commission, and for Duncan Alford to fill an unexpired term on the Accommodations Tax Committee, Advisory Committee, representing the majority of revenue category. And then we discussed three county commissions and the ordinances that we discovered at our retreat that we're not sure they really meet anymore, or why we have them, or if we should still have them. So we directed county attorney and management to look into those ordinances and see how we should proceed with that. And then we got a short update from the finance director on budgeting and how revenue is coming in as things seem to be picking back up from COVID.
Thank you, Mr. Winkler. Any council new non-agenda comments?
I think that's my section right there.
Mr. Roddy.
Yeah. I just want to encourage everyone who pays attention or don't pay attention to what we're doing with York County. We're entering our budget talks now, and so few times do we see people come and get involved in what we're doing, how we're spending your money, looking at what we're actually doing, whether we're, if you feel like we're overspending, underspending, keeping your taxes low, raise them too high, get involved in this process, because all too often when I see people out, they ask questions later. Now's the time to ask questions about what we're doing with your tax dollars. This, I'll tell you, this council has always worked hard to keep taxes at a minimum. You know, I can toot that horn. I've been here 10 years now, and we've always put the taxpayers' interest first when it comes to raising your taxes, lowering your taxes. We keep the taxpayers in mind to do all we can to minimize the impact. We're doing things, and we're looking at some things now going forward of ways to keep taxes low and continue to reduce them. I've said it a few short years after I got up here, is that I think we have the cheapest taxes, residential property taxes, east of the Mississippi. I think our taxes are lower here than they are in Mississippi. So we're doing a phenomenal job, and we just want more people to get involved in the process and pay attention to what we're doing. And I think you'll be very proud of what this council comes away with at the end of budget season going forward. So get involved.
Excellent. Yeah, I did.
Mr. Audette.
Yeah, so I just want to thank the public for their participation in the survey that we had around Riverview. The participation was excellent. The ideas that we got for Riverview were fantastic. So again, want to thank the community for their participation, and exciting that what we have going forward with Riverbend. So thank you.
And I just want to remind everyone about the grand opening of Ebenezer Park on May 1st. So I'm extremely excited about it being within District 6 and place that I grew up at. So,
amen. It'll be a good event. Any other council members?
Yeah. Go ahead.
So last November, the good people of the Bethel and Lake Wylie area passed a tax on themselves for green space. And knowing that green might get a little boring by itself, we did a wildflower giveaway this past weekend up at Field Day Park. Had some great vendors there with all natural and homemade products. It was a lot of fun Saturday morning. And I've dropped off a little pack of wildflower seeds at everybody's desk tonight. So
I was wondering what that was.
Yeah. It's got a sticker on there, so you kind of know, but it looks kind of funny. But they're very easy. You just scratch the ground a little bit and throw them out, maybe with some sand. And those are they're high-end perennial seeds, so all wildflowers. So I'm going to want to see your the results of your gardening. That includes y'all.
Mr. Hamilton.
Our community recently suffered a tragedy that thrust us into the national spotlight. And I just wanted to take a moment to share the way we grieve as a community, and we've all had the Leslie family in our prayers, and also to point out that our local law enforcement, again, when tested, stepped into that spotlight and shone and did a phenomenal job, and I'm grateful for all of their efforts while they continue to handle that situation.
Absolutely. I think all of us, I know at our first budget meeting that we had, which was the first meeting we had together since the incident occurred, we said a prayer together and just remembered that we mourn together. There is no way to make sense of this, but we do send our condolences out to all of the families, and we do again thank Sheriff Tolson for all of the hard work that he's put in and for those folks to help protect and serve us. Do we have a motion for executive session?
Move that we go into executive session for the receipt of legal advice. We're in a PD change regarding tax map 617, parcels 126, 77, 84, and 85, a contractual matter regarding Miller's gas and produce agreement, as well as further legal advice regarding the request for settlement authority for county engineering project 16245, tract 126.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, we will move straight into executive session. We are out of executive session. No action was taken. Do we have any motions?
We do. I move to approve settlement authority. I'm sorry, regarding county engineering project number 16245, tract 126, motion to approve settlement authority as recommended by our legal staff.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, motion passes. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.